Hey everybody, this is David, and today I am going to be talking about another Marvel movie, Iron Man 2. And the reason why I am talking about this, if you haven't guessed already, is that I am going back and reviewing all the Marvel films because Avengers Age of Ultron is coming out this year, and so I already did Iron Man 3 and Guardians of the Galaxy a long time ago. And so I'm doing the rest of them, and I already did Iron Man 1 and The Incredible Hulk, and now I'm doing Iron Man 2. And so let's get through this. What did I think was great about this movie, or not great? First, let's start off with Tony Stark himself, Robert Downey Jr. Once again, he delivers, and this is why we love him as Iron Man. He is just great. He's funny. He can be dramatic. He has everything that embodies Iron Man and what he should be. And I think it's great. I think some really cool parts is seeing how, you know, down Iron Man is in this movie, seeing Robert Downey Jr. handle those heavy parts, because in this movie he is dying because he finds out that the arc reactor on his chest is killing him slowly. And a lot of that is really cool in this movie. That's what I really, you know, I think this movie is a little bit underrated, because I know a lot of people say this movie isn't as good as Iron Man 1. But me personally, I actually like this movie more than Iron Man 1. I know I'm probably going to be the few people that will say that. But yeah, I think Iron Man 2 hits all the spots right. And a lot of people might, I've heard people say that, you know, the middle of the movie gets a little bit boring, but I don't think so. I love this movie all the way through. I think it's just as good, maybe an inch better than the first film. And most of that is to do with Tony's story throughout this movie. You know, he's not just, you know, dying, but he's also trying to reconnect again with his father, which is really cool. We see John Slattery play the older version of Howard Stark before we get to Captain America. So it's cool seeing a little bit of Howard Stark and getting to know a little bit about him, because this is also the movie that we discover that he was one of, you know, the people who founded S.H.I.E.L.D., which is really cool, especially now that, you know, we're so many years away from Iron Man 2. Now we're seeing Agent Carter, which is showing some of that, and obviously in Captain America, the first Avenger, we see that, you know, Howard Stark did help Captain America during World War II and all that. So it's really cool seeing all of it come together, and especially connected. It really helps connect Howard and Tony's storyline together. Another thing I have to point out is Robert Downey Jr. and Gwyneth Paltrow's chemistry together. Once again, proving that, you know, this is probably the best superhero couple in any superhero film to date. It's definitely one of my favorites. And every movie and show that I like, you know, there's two things I really don't like when it comes to films. And it's the horror genre and romance. I could do without the romance, but I get why it's there. If I had to pick between romance and horror, I'd probably go with the romance more, just because I think there's a little bit more credibility there, story-wise. And but that's just me. I know everyone has their opinions, and that's cool. But for me, you know, Robert Downey Jr. and Gwyneth Paltrow, I can watch them, you know, interact with each other for ages. I think they both just have tremendous chemistry. We also have Don Cheadle as the new Rhodey, who took over for Terrence Howard due to some complications behind the scenes. And personally, I know I said this in the Iron Man 1 review, but I love Don Cheadle more than Terrence Howard in the role. I think Terrence Howard was great also, but Don Cheadle, to me, I just like him in the role better. I think he's better suited, and to me, I think he has better chemistry with Robert Downey Jr. than Terrence Howard. I think Terrence Howard was great too, and I don't want to take that away from him, but to me, I can see why Don Cheadle was probably the first choice, the original choice for Rhodey before they casted Terrence Howard in the first film. And it was great seeing him suit up as War Machine. Once again, even though I also think, you know, it would have been cool to see Terrence Howard in this role, Don Cheadle just knocks it out of the park. We also get some new villains, such as Whiplash, played by Mickey Rourke, aka Ivan Vanko. He plays Ivan Vanko in this one. And that was really cool. I don't know too much about Iron Man's villains. All my knowledge from these comic book characters comes from mostly the animated shows. I've read very few comics, especially when it comes to Iron Man. The only comics I read with Iron Man are the Ultimate Avengers. So other than that, I wasn't too familiar with his rogues gallery. And Whiplash, I think he's pretty badass, man. He doesn't say much. You don't know too much about his backstory and all that. But to me, I think he feels threatening enough. And I remember reading interviews with Mickey Rourke saying that he had wished that, you know, that Jon Favreau would have pushed Marvel a little bit more to allow his character to be more developed. And even though I kind of agree with that statement, I see what Marvel's position is. If there isn't enough time, focus more on the hero. I think that's what Marvel's strategy is. That's why in a lot of their films, it feels like a lot of characters are pushed to the side and more room for the hero to be developed. And it makes more sense that way. But yes, I wish we would get more Lokis out of it, because Loki is one of the great villains from the Marvel Cinematic Universe. And yeah, there could have been a lot more potential with Whiplash. As a character, I think he's less interesting than Jeff Bridges' character from the first film, but as a villain who goes out and has to fight Tony Stark, I feel he was a much better threat. We also have Sam Rockwell in this movie playing Justin Hammer, who is a competitor to Tony Stark, and he aligns himself with Whiplash in this movie. And I gotta say, I love Sam Rockwell. Every movie he's in, he's always amazing. And to me, he has some of the best lines in this movie, along with Robert Downey Jr., especially when they both clash together. I think that's like some of the funniest dialogue being thrown around in the movie. I think he's just as funny as Robert Downey Jr. is, in my opinion. And I'm kind of disappointed we haven't had him back in Iron Man 3. So who knows, maybe Iron Man 4 he'll return, because he kind of made that threat at the end. And it kind of made me, you know, hoping he would return, and he never did. Unless you watch that short featuring Ben Kingsley as the Mandarin, or returning as Trevor Slattery or whatever the name was. He returns, and at the end of the credits of that short film, which the name is escaping me right now, Sam Rockwell has a little cameo in that short film. So I believe it's on the Captain America the Winter Soldier DVD. No, it's on the Thor the Dark World DVD. So go check that out. It's a good short film. It's pretty good. Not the best one, but it's good. And Sam Rockwell has a little cameo at the end during the credits, so it's really cool. Of course, just like all the Marvel movies, we get a lot of references and characters that are being set up for future films. And one of those characters is Natasha, aka the Black Widow, played by Scarlett Johansson. And yeah, I mean, she's really cool in this movie, but she's not really given a lot to learn about her character. She's just a badass, plain and simple, and someone who's looking after Tony Stark for Nick Fury, and making sure he's, you know, not going overboard with the superhero business, and making sure he doesn't, you know, kill himself with the reactor, because she knows there's something wrong with him. She doesn't find out until later. So yeah, I mean, I like Scarlett. Who doesn't love Scarlett Johansson? I mean, Lucy was a not-so-great movie, and that movie did amazing in theater. So, but, you know, for this character, she is badass. She definitely has a badass side, and I wouldn't mind a Black Widow movie, you know? As long as she's teamed up with Hawkeye, because I don't think we're getting enough of Jeremy Renner in this universe. But, you know, Black Widow kicks ass. And then we also got Nick Fury back. Samuel Jackson returns as Nick Fury, and he has a few scenes that, you know, also help tie into the universe of what Marvel's been building up to, especially the Avengers. With him, you get a lot of Avengers references, and you get a little bit of, again, Howard Stark, and that's where Howard Stark's backstory comes into play a little bit. We learn a little bit about Howard Stark thanks to Nick Fury. And but Nick Fury always remains mysterious. I think the most we ever got out of him was in Captain America: The Winter Soldier. But this was definitely the starting point of something big. And his scene towards the end with Robert Downey Jr. was also really nice. He's there mostly to set up the Avengers and what's to come, but also to give Tony information on his father and on Ivan Vanko's father as well, because there's a connection there between the two of them. Another cameo I want to mention is Gary Shandling as Senator Stern. His role isn't too big in this movie, but he is there to cause a little bit of trouble for Tony Stark. And the reason why I want to bring him up a little bit, because he's part of the reason why the government wants Tony Stark's Iron Man suits. The government is after his suits in this movie, but we learn in Captain America: The Winter Soldier that he's actually a Hydra agent. And when you go back and watch Iron Man 2 now, knowing that, it kind of gives Iron Man 2 a little bit more of more layers to it. Because now knowing that he's a Hydra agent means that Hydra was actually after Iron Man's suits, because they figured that Tony Stark was a threat. So I wanted to point that out a little bit, that I thought was interesting now looking back at Iron Man 2 and knowing that Senator Stern turns out to be a Hydra agent in Captain America: Winter Soldier. It really does give more layers now to Iron Man 2. Of course, we also get Agent Coulson, who's in this movie once again, just like he was in the original movie. But in my opinion, this is one of the weaknesses of the film. Coulson just seems to be in there just to bridge the connection between another Marvel film, which is Thor. And literally, he's only in the movie for two scenes, and both of them really bring nothing to the plot. And to me, maybe that's one of the weaknesses people had, but to me, it's like two really short scenes that don't really have much to, you know, they're very short, and they don't bring the movies down. To me, they actually help all the Marvel movies as a whole. If I'm going to view Iron Man 2 on its own, then these scenes are pretty dumb and pointless. They're only good if you're following all the films. Unlike Iron Man 1, I feel that Iron Man 2 actually improves upon the action sequences. Where the first movie, they didn't feel like they were playing around more with the action, and if they did, it was really brief and quick. Which is cool, but you know, with your superheroes, you want a little bit more cooler action sequences. And even though I wouldn't say these action sequences are like extreme and badass and whatever, they are a little bit better than the first film. But then again, Favreau isn't really a action director, but he is a good director. And I think he does a really good job, once again, with like character scenes that help, you know, give the characters time to shine. And when it comes to the action, I think he does a good job in this one, much better than he did in the first film. So that's kind of also why I give Iron Man 2 a little bit more points compared to the first film. Other than that, guys, I'm going to be giving Iron Man 2 an 8 out of 10. I really enjoy this movie. I thought it was a nice, steady sequel to the first film. Like I said before, you know, I actually like Iron Man 2 just a bit more than Iron Man 1. I think both of them are great films. But this one, to me, it's more fun. Especially if you're like into the comics and you want to like know, you want to see those Easter eggs and stuff like that. It's funny because like I don't read comics, but I love seeing the Easter eggs, especially when learning about them, what they actually mean from other fans. Like, you know, like Captain America's shield was there, and that was an obvious reference for someone like me. But there were other references too that kind of set up the universe and where they were heading with this. And I can see why, though, a lot of people might not enjoy this one as much as the first one. But for me, I just enjoy it a lot. I think it's a great film and a lot of fun. And I guess that's all, guys. So until next time, take care.